just so excited to be in the service one more time. What about y'all? Well, come on, stand up on your feet and give God some praise then. He's truly worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the sea, he's so worthy. Amen. Amen. We're going to open up with a word of prayer, and then we'll have the praise team and do what we do. Amen. God bless you. Thanking you again for touching us with your finger and touch of love, Lord. Lord, we've done nothing to deserve that, but because of your goodness and your grace and your mercy, Lord, we're here today. And we just want to say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Oh, hallelujah, Lord. We said it 10,000 times, it wouldn't be enough to praise your most holy name, Lord. Lord, as we come before you in service today in worship, we ask, Lord, that you would just come down and dwell within our spirits, Lord. If you would just touch our bodies, let us feel your presence, Lord. Let every church open up in the name of, if you feel your presence this morning, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you will go out to the byways and the highways of this life. Touch those that are saved. Touch those that are unsaved, Lord. We ask, Father, that someone will wake up this morning and say, I yield, I yield. What must I do to be saved, Lord? We pray, Lord, that that person will be in the house today, in someone's house today, Lord. We ask, Lord, that someone's here to be saying the same thing. Lord, someone's not able to make it to church this morning, Lord, but they still want to praise you. Yeah. Ask, Lord, that you would reach into their house, to their apartment. Touch them, Lord. Touch them, Lord. Let them know that you're still here, that you're still reigning supreme, Lord, and that we can do nothing without you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, I love you so much, Jesus. Lord, and when we've done all we can do, we can't pray no more. We can't sing another song, Lord. We ask, Father, that you would give us a home in your eternal kingdom where we can sing praises, praise your name throughout ceaseless ages, Lord. And let the children of God say, amen, 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 amen. 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 Yes.
Yes. and we had an hour early. It's really 9 o'clock to me, but we still gonna stand up. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Our Father is here, we go. Our Father is here. Spread it up.
Oh! I'm thinking Don Dead, my wife Dean's Christmas Dead, my daughter Bread Dead. We greet you from People's Missionary Baptist Church under the guidance of Dr. Robert Lodge, Jr., 2002. We come to worship with Pastor Duckworth. Him and my brother went to college together, but my brother didn't make it because he didn't sense a lot. So, I'm here for a conversation with my brother and his family, and we're here to worship with you guys. I'm going to be here.
Thank you. That's how long I've been blessed by the family and the friendship and the brotherhood travel with us.
Amen. As we went to Dexter Avenue, we had a wonderful celebration of their 101st anniversary, church anniversary. We thank God for all of you that come. I never think of the grand from being there. If I did not get a chance to speak to you Wednesday, I'm saying I thank you now. Amen. Praise God for you. Also, I want to remind everyone that this afternoon we got to go to Pontiac to New York Baptist Church and who's on me? Get there at 1:30, they're going to start serving dinner. Amen. 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 And then afterwards at 3 o'clock, we will be there worshiping. Amen. Helping Pastor Peyton, my good brother, and friend, celebrate 13 years. Amen. In the pastoral ministry. So we're looking forward to a wonderful fellowship. We want to be mindful of all the announcements that are listed here. We have a ton of things going on. This coming Saturday is our first ministry head meeting. So we're asking all of our leaders to care and will to be there as we talk about the events coming up. We look in the bulletins. We have some things going on. Following Saturday, the 21st, there will be a home buyer's fair here at our church. Amen. It is not sponsored by us, but we are hosting it. It was hosted at another church. They had a conflict in their calendars, and I immediately stepped up and said, we will host it. Amen. So they're coming. It's a wonderful opportunity. Please read up on it. Take advantage of it. Invite someone if you know them. They can benefit from that. And then on the following Sunday, the 22nd, we'll be having right after morning service training from Narcan. Amen. And those things. And so the opiate addiction, we're trying to stay on top of things as a church family. Amen. We don't want to be good to you spiritually. We want to be good to you once you are the church. Amen. And so we want to take advantage of that. I don't know if there's a census commercial or not, but I do know that the social justice ministry will be meeting directly after service today. And they need to have a meeting. I believe the career club is also meeting. Is that correct? They're also meeting today right after service. So we have two meetings going on. We want to be mindful of all the announcements existing in your revival. In your announcements and revival is forthcoming. Yeah. And we are 2 weeks away. Amen. If you have not heard Dr. F. Bruce Williams, you need to come. Yeah. I promise you, if you come one day, I don't have to worry about the next two. You will be here. Amen. I told him that we were excited, and he said he's just as excited as you are to come here. Amen. He said, not even the coronavirus will keep him coming. Amen. And so we're looking forward to the Lord using him. I do want to say on behalf of the Davis family, the Chiefs family, for those in central prayers, for those that showed up on this day, we do appreciate you for coming and being a part. And I just, as I shared at 8 o'clock, it's just a blessing to have clergy that are trained in what to do and what not to do. And for those that go to other churches, not knocking other churches, but you often can see the difference. And hopefully it will help you appreciate what we're trying to do here at our church. Yesterday, Pastor had mentioned and said, hey, listen, if you're asked to read scripture, simply read scripture. If you're asked to sing, simply sing. If you're asked, whatever you're asked to do, give your mind to all you do what you're asked to do. And of course, you know how some folks are. Some of our cousins, amen. If it's Saturday, show themselves, amen. And I just think it's a total disrespect to the family and to the memory of the deceased when folks are going beyond what they're supposed to do. Unfortunately, the preacher got up and went the wrong way. Into the fact that I know the pastor said, oh, do what you have to do, but I just had a scene and then had the nerve to say, I'm not out of order, and I couldn't clearly say that you are out of order. Amen. I was verbal, I was thinking, so it just came out. You are out of order. You are out of order. Amen. Needless to say, after the march, we didn't see them no more. Amen. But it just goes to show that you all want to tell us why I do what I do, because I think there's a certain amount of respect that is due to the memory of the deceased, amen. And I think we need to be respectful of the family that is grieving and all the things they have ahead of them. And for them to sit service for hours because some of us is not directly involved in the perform. I don't think that's the menu for that. And so I just want to say that I appreciate one of my nurses for sharing with me. She went to a funeral, and I believe the eulogist preached over 2 hours. Amen. I take it that was all the eulogies for years. Amen. Amen. Let me be more. I just want to share with you all why we do what we do, because I just believe there's a certain amount of respect. Amen. That is due. Amen. It's not minimizing the memory of a loved one, but it's being memorable that folks still got to go to the grave site. Folks still got a lot of grief ahead of them, and I'm always mindful of that. And I just have watched too many performances at funerals. Amen. And that's not the time for that. Amen. So I just wanted to say that. I appreciate you again. So our visitors that are here, God bless you. For those who stood, and for those who did not stand, and for those who will probably be trickling in the next 15, 20 minutes, and hopefully they won't let that stop from coming. Amen. They still get the prayer, the song, and everything else in. Amen. We thank God for our music ministry. We thank God for this. Amen. still works.
Break.
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 Break. Which one of God was out? Come on, push it out. Lock the shoot. What's your name?
that we cannot forgive what you've done for us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Giving honor to God, the end of our life, to all of you, my brothers and sisters, to all of our officers, to those of you that remember to get up this morning, the extra hour of rest, you're here. Amen. And for those that forget, amen. And to all of you, to our visitors, we thank God. There is a word this morning. We do know that we have to travel to Pontiac. Matter of fact, the bus is leaving at 12:30. Amen. It's leaving at 12:30, so we won't be here all day. Amen. Amen. So we want to give an opportunity for the Lord to say something, and then we'll go ahead and hear what the Lord has to say this afternoon. The Gospel of John, Mark, the fifth chapter. The Gospel of John, Mark, the fifth chapter. If you get an opportunity, you can read the entire chapter. Amen. For 11. For our purposes this morning, we want to lift up a few of the verses that speaks to us, and they will probably be a part two coming up. John Mark, 5th chapter, first verse reads this way, New Living Translation. So they arrived at the other side of the lake, in the region of the Gerasenes. When Jesus climbed out of the boat, a man possessed by an evil spirit came out from the tombs to meet him. This man lived in the burial caves and could no longer be restrained, even with a chain. Whenever he was put into chains and shackles, as he often was, he snapped the chains from his wrists and smashed the shackles. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Day and night, he wandered among the burial caves and in the hills, hollowing and cutting himself with sharp stones. When Jesus was still some distance away, a man saw him, ran to meet him, and bowed low before him. With a shriek, he screams, "Why are you interfering with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In the name of God, I beg you, don't torture me." For Jesus had already said to the spirit, "Come out of this man, you evil spirit." Crowds soon gathered around Jesus, and they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons. He was sitting there fully clothed and perfectly sane, and they were all afraid. As Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon possessed begged to go with them. But Jesus said, "No, go home to your family and tell them everything the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been."
Amen.
Father, speak this morning. Jesus meets a disturbed brother. Jesus meets a disturbed brother. One of the biggest misconceptions and misunderstandings about coming to Jesus is that one will have to get themselves right first. Often I hear folks who know they need to be in church but declare that they have no desire to be a hypocrite or phony like everyone else, so they'll just wait until they get themselves straight. Then they'll come. There is this great misnomer that one can only come to church or to Jesus after they have straightened themselves out and up. But can I be real this morning?
Amen.
You don't come to church, you don't come to Jesus because you are straightened out. You come to church and on Jesus because Jesus is able to straighten you out.
That's right.
You don't come to church because you haven't done anything wrong. You don't come to church because you have committed any sins. You come to church because you realize you have done wrong. and you have committed some sin, you don't come to church because you are holy and all straight. You come because you are not holy, and you know that you need divine help to get you home. See, I know every church has some self-righteous, never done anything wrong, supercilious, super saint Pharisees.
Oh, preach!
Believe me, the church is not for them.
Preach!
The church is not for the perfect. The church is not for those that have never done anything wrong. The church is not for the well. The church is not for the always right. The church is not for the sinless. It is not for the flawless. It is not for the spiritual snobs who look down on everyone else. I'm telling you, Dr. D, if the church isn't for the folks who are already straightened out and sinless, then who is the church for? Glad you asked. God's church that God owns, that Jesus died and paid for, and that the Holy Ghost controls, is for the imperfect who strive for perfection. It is for the always doing something wrong who trying to get it right. It's for the sick who understands that there is a position. It is for the always wrong learning how to get power to do it right. It is for the sinner who have been forgiven, who have their sin debt paid. It is for the flawed who have their faults covered by love. It is for the spiritual strong who reach down to help someone else up. There is no such thing as getting right before you come to church. You can't get right, and if you could, then Jesus wasted his time and his life on Calvary. This makes about as much sense as taking a shower in order to take a bath. You don't come to church because you are right. You come to church to encounter Jesus who can get you right.
Amen.
3 weeks ago, I decided to become a monthly car wash club member. This allows me unlimited car washes per month, so I don't have to try and dodge the rain or snow because I can go as often as I want to. However, one thing that's for certain is that I won't be going to the unlimited car wash because my Traverse is clean. I go because it's dirty. See, I don't come here because I have it all figured out. I come here because I heard that Jesus has already worked it out. And see, here's our thesis for this burning sermon. No matter what condition or shape you are in, you can still come to Jesus. No matter how you are dressed, you can still come to Jesus. No matter who you are, you can still come to Jesus. No matter where you've been, you can still come to Jesus. No matter what you've done, you can still come to Jesus. No matter what's been done to you, you can still come to Jesus. No matter the condition you are in when you get here, you can still come to Jesus. Regardless of the addiction or the affliction that you're dealing with, you can still come to Jesus. No matter who you vote for, you can still come to Jesus. But if you vote for I-45, we need to get you here real quick. No matter where you live or who live currently, you can still come to Jesus. Well, our title said Jesus meets a disturbed brother. So we're going to look at 3 reasons why this brother has been labeled disturbed, and then we're going to really let you go so you can get the Pontiac. Let's be real. One of the hardest tasks in America is to be a brother because your mere existence causes disturbance to some folks. See, but it's also disturbing to me the situation that many brothers find themselves in. It's disturbing to know that we are the most targeted and most convicted. It is disturbing to know that we are sentenced to longer prison terms for petty and non-violent crimes. It's disturbing to me that most police departments across the country will follow us, and folk are more likely to hold their possessions in an elevator once we get on it. It bothers me to know that all of our athletes and entertainers are fine as long as they are the goose that lays the golden eggs. It bothers me to know that most school districts don't even count on our fathers being active in the education of our children or the poor. It bothers me to know the media always tend to show us as the worst and a mere example of us. It bothers me as more prisons are becoming prioritized or privatized. Companies are actually engaging in modern-day slavery, but having inmates produce their products for little or next to nothing. It's brothers who are populating the prisons, even though we're not
not doing any more crimes than anyone else. That bothers me, but I'm texting the teacher today. Who is his third brother came to Jesus one way, but when Jesus got finished with him, he left another way. That's good news. The first sign of this disturbed brother was where he lived. Seven verses before Jesus had told his disciples it was time for a road trip. They are now arriving at their next destination, the land of the Gerasenes. And verse 2 says, before Jesus can even get out of the boat, John Mark declares that this disturbed brother met him. This verse describes where this disturbed brother came from. Verse 3 said that this brother lived among the tombs. He lived in the cemetery, and he could not be restrained. Based upon where this brother lived is enough evidence to support my argument that this brother here is disturbed. Disturbed is defined as symptoms of mental illness, a destroying the tranquility or composure thereof, throwing something in disorder, an ill effect on one's peace of mind, insane, psychotic, or deranged. This account is recorded by all three synoptic authors. Matthew describes two men, but Mark and Luke focuses only on one. Is this not indicative of many of our brothers? Many of our good brothers are now living a disturbed life, and it is often because of the environment in which they live. This is not to suggest that you are doomed to a disturbed life because you live in the hood, but if you're not conscious, you can become a product of your environment. But it's also possible to live in the hood and yet be profane. And it's also possible to live in Beverly Hills and be straight hood. This brother lived among the dead. He lived in an environment where life had already been sucked out. You see, you don't have to live in a cemetery to live in an environment where there is no life. King James calls this brother unclean because the Jews consider the tombs unclean since they didn't touch dead bodies. If you are here this morning and it appears that your life is in disorder, you feel disturbed, it could be because you are living in an environment in a situation that has no life residing in it. But let me stop right here. All cemeteries don't have headstones. All cemeteries don't have weekly visits from the funeral home directors and processional. One's home could be a cemetery. If there is no growth occurring, it's a cemetery. If there are no new thoughts being thought, it's a cemetery. If there are no new dreams being dreamt, it's a cemetery. If there are no new aspirations being considered, no inspiration of self-development and self-improvement, no desire for education and wisdom, no respect or regard for lives or how folks live their lives, if none of these characteristics are present in your house, then you are probably having an environment that produces disturbed brothers and sisters because they're living in a dead environment. Just living with you can control where you live regardless of your address. I like that. But then the second sign that this brother was disturbed was how he lived. First of all, we talked about where he lived. He lived among the dead. But now, how he lived. Verse 4 starts with some disturbing news. This brother's life was so out of control that others had tried to constrain him. You don't really normally constrain someone whose life has you don't usually restrain someone whose life is productive. This wasn't a one-time occurrence because John Mark says that whenever he was put into chains and shackles, he would snap the chains from his wrist and smash the shackles. This verse indicates that this brother was so disturbed that society was afraid to have him on the streets, and therefore they felt the only way to control him was to burn him. Isn't that strange that 2020, so many of our brothers, our cousins, our fathers, grandsons, nephews, sons, and uncles are locked up. Many of them are locked up because society has no other way of controlling them because they live their lives out of control. They don't live a life with order and tranquility, but their life is full of chaos and disorder. This disturbed brother had lost everything. He lost home and fellowship with his family and friends. He lost decency as he ran around naked and improperly dressed. stress. He lost self-control, and therefore, like an animal, he lived by instinct instead of intelligence and reasoning that God had given him. He lived without peace and purpose for living. Therefore, it didn't matter how he lived, nor how long he lived. And we had too many good brothers who are living a disturbed lifestyle that have landed them in a chained situation. Yep. He was so out of control that he lived a life of a repeat offender. No one was strong enough to control him. No one was able to get him to change his mentality. And if chains and shackles don't get your attention, if the loss of personal freedom don't get your attention, what in the world will? And someone here today, you're living a disturbed brother's lifestyle, and folks are seemingly trying to control you with chains, but you keep breaking them. This is a dangerous, and Dr. D is concerned about you, because scripture teaches that when you don't practice self-control, you will practice self-destructive behavior. Let me say that again. When you don't practice self-control, you will practice self-destructive behavior. Verse 5 describes how he lived his life day and night, loud, hitting himself with stones, making 2020. All day long and night, he's running around the hood, making a bunch of loud noise, and ultimately self-inflicting himself. The man isn't doing it to this brother. This brother is doing it to himself. No one else is making him get high on drugs. No one else is making him sell drugs. No one else is making him get drunk, carjack, rob and steal, engage in illegal activity, make him stay at home and not do honest day's work. This disturbed brother is living a life of self-destruction because he isn't living a life of self-control. Isn't it odd that often disturbed brothers can get the ear of Act 45? You all remember that when he had those trees at the White House for a photo op, and he didn't allow them to say anything. Y'all remember that? Fast forward, and Kanye West showed up at the White House. I 45 gave him the mic, and around 10 minutes of ranting and raving, and nobody said nothing. Now, before we get too hard on this brother, there must be an explanation as to what's really disturbing him or what is causing so much disorder in his life. Well, the final sign of this disturbed brother was who lived in him. First of all, where he lived. The second sign was how he lived. But now we want to go deeper and figure out who's living in him. There's a reason why this brother is living among the cemetery, and why this brother is living a self-destructive life. This brother is partly responsible because the old proverb is true, what's in you will come out. Actually, the second verse explained why this normal brother was living a lifestyle of chaos and was completely out of control. This brother has a live-in problem. His problem is on the inside. This brother is corrupt. He's disturbed by what's living inside of him. This brother is demon-possessed. And the devil's powers are exercised by either Satan, demons, or human influence or possessed. Please believe that demon possession is not a figment of Hollywood's imagination with The Exorcist, Carrie, The Shining, Amityville Horror, Fall of Denzel, Paranormal Activity, or The Rat. You can't tell me you believe in God, God's angels, and not believe in the devil and Satan's demons. Demons are the angels that were kicked out of heaven along with Lucifer because pride made him lose his mind up in there. This is not to suggest that just because one has mental illness, they are automatically possessed by demons. History tells us that even in this country, the minute one has mental illness, they were cast away. Originally, prisons were homes for the mentally insane. They were not for prisoners, they were for the mentally insane. If you don't believe in demon possession, then explain to me how a son could kill his mother and father. How a husband could kill his children, wife, and then himself. Explain to me how a person can rape a woman or a man. Explain to me how serial killers can invent ways to kill. kill other folk. Explain to me how some folk enjoy starting wars with bringing death in large numbers. Explain to me why pedophiles can entice even children to have sex with children. Explain to me how a person can hate a person that they've never really been around. And perhaps that's the problem with I-45. Maybe, just maybe, he didn't possess. I mean, it was his faith, his hatred, his phobia, the evil that prompts and he celebrates. Demon possession is a desperate, satanic attempt to destroy and destroy God's image in humanity. For sinners, you can be demon possessed, and for saints, you can be demon influenced. Many saints, and I know I'm going to treat y'all like I said, but I can tell you this. There are some folks who lie on it up. Not only I-45, there are some folks who lie on the devil. The devil made me do it. The devil don't make you do anything. The devil simply makes doing something more convincing, makes it more enticing. But if you are a child of God, you already know before you do it, it's wrong. You can go ahead and do it. The devil will appear to your desire to please self, and whatever is attracted to you, he will use against you. But verse 6 recognizes that even if one is demon-possessed, they can still recognize who Jesus is. Because the Bible says, at a distance, the man ran to Jesus and made the first occurrence as such a divine designation of Jesus in all of the New Testament, even though he was full of the devil. Because the Bible said he was legion, with meaning at least 6,000 demons were in him. He worshiped Jesus, even though he was full of it. He was able to worship Jesus, even though he had some stuff going on inside of him. Once he recognized who Jesus was, he couldn't help but give him some praise. I just stopped right there because some of us say we've been envious of all that stuff. We come to church and we can't give God praise, but if the devil inside of a man can't help but worship God, and around the world we come to church week after week and do good and do holy and lift our hands and shout our feet and tell the Lord thank you for what the Lord has done for me. I like this because Jesus went directly to the heart of the problem. He told the demons to come on out. In between the verses, there's some dialogue between Jesus and the demons. But I want to end this morning with good news is that Jesus met this disturbed brother, but left him a disciple with a testimony. Okay. Jesus met this disturbed brother, but when it was all over and done with, this disturbed brother was converted into a disciple with a testimony. All right, unless you agree on this, Jesus left the crowd to come to this brother. In the last chapter, Jesus also came through a storm to reach and rescue this one disturbed brother. Somebody ought to be pulling it right now. Jesus left a crowd, endured a storm, just to reach and rescue this disturbed brother. Jesus left the crowd, went through a storm, just to find this one brother who was disturbed. Jesus left the crowd, endured a storm, to reach out and rescue a brother that had been attacked. But I'm going to tell you something. Satan understands that Satan cannot stop God from blessing you. But Satan understands that he can delay you from getting your blessing. That's why sometimes it's hard to come to church. You can make the work on Monday, but when it's time to get up on Sunday morning, you're too tired because Satan understands that God has a blessing for you. Satan can't stop God from blessing you, but Satan can delay you from getting your blessing. And a lot of us are not blessed, not because God doesn't have blessing for us, but we have allowed Satan to delay us from our blessing. This is good news, because no matter what condition you find yourself in, Jesus will lead the crowd and count a storm just to reach and rescue you. I like this. Can I say it one more time? Jesus will lead the crowd, go through a storm just to reach and rescue you. See, it's true that you can come to church one way and leave another. This brother met Jesus in a disturbed situation, but Jesus left him a disciple with a testimony. See, after the demons were evicted and cast into the water, the crowd was astounded to see this same out-of-control disturbed brother. Now he's sitting. Well, why is he sitting? Because the Bible explains to us that usually disciples or learners often learn at the feet of their instructors. In other words, now this brother that was running through the cemetery, cutting himself, yelling and screaming all night long, half naked, running around with his situation exposed, now he's no longer, he has clothes on, he's sitting down in a learning position, and the Bible says, then there's a pop, God. This brother had been living his life, he had been exposed, he had been mentally challenged, he had been cutting himself, he had been screaming and hollering all night long, going back and forth. Now order is back in this man's life. He's sitting, he's learning, and he's dressed for poking. Well, here comes Father. Unfortunately, some folks were mad. He had been living in sin. He had been uncontrollable and changed. He had been self-mutilating and self-afflicting himself. And now he meets Jesus. Jesus cast the demons out, and now some folks are mad. 2,000 pigs had killed himself. And the people begged Jesus to leave. See, there are some folks who profit from brothers whose lives are out of control. See, there are some folks who don't mind when our kids act the fool, because they're already ready to make a profit off of the ill behavior that our children will display. There are some folks who will lose money if these brothers are to be delivered from their current situation. Well, Jesus is getting ready to leave. This brother wants to follow Jesus and serve the one who brought him from a disturbed situation. Now listen to this. Strangely, Jesus does not allow him to follow him. Throughout most of the scriptures, Jesus is always saying, come follow me. Now, if anybody had a reason to follow Jesus, it would have been this disturbed brother. Now remember, when he met him, he was living in a cemetery. He was not dressed well. He was naked. He was hurting himself, afflicting himself day and night. He was screaming and hollering, cutting himself, cutting the poop day and night, loud, all that stuff going on. He meets Jesus. Jesus touches, tells the demons to come out of him. Now he's in the same position, and now all of a sudden, Jesus heals him. He recognizes who Jesus healed him. Jesus wants to follow him, and Jesus tells him no. He does not allow him to follow him, but he tells him to go home and share what the Lord has done for him. It's strange because between verses 8 and 15, which we're going to talk about next time, the demons ask Jesus for a favor. And he grants the demons a favor, but denies this brother's request. I like this because Jesus is informing us of how we should behave once we've been set free. See, if the Lord has set you free, then you ought to go home, you ought to collect your friends, you ought to collect your family, and tell everybody you the Lord has done something for you, you ought to share it with everyone else. Don't worry, I have a witness today who don't mind telling of the good things the Lord has done for you. Well, I don't mind sharing with you this morning that I too was a disturbed brother. But thanks to Jesus, I'm no longer the same, because he found my anxiety and assured it. He found my burden and lifted it. He found my cure and destroyed it. He found my debt and paid it. He found my guilt and forgave it. He found my fault and pardoned it. He found my hunger and satisfied it. He found my question and answered it.
Yeah.
who was living in a dead situation, was living foul, had badness living in them. But one day, they met Jesus, and he changed their life. He changed their trajectory of their life. They went from being disturbed to a disciple with a testimony. That's why the Lord blesses us, to share our testimony. That's why when folks look at you strange, because they remember what you used to do. And that's your testimony. It's not because I've been so good. It's not because I'm so smart. But it's because I ran into a man named Jesus who touched our situation, changed our condition. It's because of him I can say thank you.
Thank you.
come on, raise your hand. God bless you. Let us say amen. Let us say amen again. Let us say amen again. We thank God for the special. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Y'all thought he was already here. I told you. Amen. Amen. We thank God. We thank God. Now this time again, we're getting on a good time. I will say better, but it is 12. Amen. It's 12 noon. The bus will be leaving in half an hour. So we got enough time to shake a few hands again. If you're concerned, after you can shake some hands, you can do some hand sanitizer. Amen. And amen. Amen. But I think we good. Amen. But I have no problem. Amen. If you have chronic disease, lung disease, heart disease, or diabetes, you are twice as likely. Amen. But I just believe the Lord is watching over us. And I'm going to tell you not to take the necessary precautions you should be doing anyway. Amen. Nothing wrong with hygiene. Cleanliness is next to godliness. It's not in the Bible, Lord. Amen. But it's a pretty good concept. Amen. Amen. Let us stand as our mothers and those with physical challenges come first. Amen. And remind your brothers and sisters to set the clock forward. Amen. I know they ain't gonna miss out like this tomorrow. Amen. 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 As we're standing, Lord, we thank you now for your goodness, your kindness, and your mercy. We thank you for your ability to meet us in a disturbed situation and leave us as disciples, testifying about what you've done for us. Lord, we ask your blessing upon us on this day, Lord. We thank you for the professional coming to be a part of our church family officially, Lord. We thank you for those that are considering coming, Lord. And Lord, we thank you for those that will be traveling with us in Pontiac. We ask your blessings upon their vehicles, Lord, that we'll all arrive safe and sound. Lord, we thank you for the meetings that will take place, Lord. We ask for your guidance in those meetings, Lord. We thank you for our church family, Lord. We ask, Lord, as we go to the polls on Tuesday, Lord, that we understand the responsibility as Christians we have to voice our opinion, let our voices be heard, Lord, through the vote. And Lord, if there's anyone here who chooses not to vote, Lord, I ask you to trouble them, Lord. All week long. Don't give them no rest, Lord. Don't give them no rest, Lord. If they fail not to vote, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I do pray. And Lord, watch. Between me and thee. While we're absent from each other, hug someone and tell them you love them.
Finish.